And thanks, Rod, so much. Good morning, everybody. It's great to be with you here this morning. So good to have you join us here for worship this morning as well. And this morning, you know, we are wrapping up our Deeply Rooted series. It's been 7 weeks. Well, today will be week number 7 in this series. And this morning, we're going to talk about what it means to be deeply rooted in community. Well, one of the things that I enjoy a lot is I enjoy going to places like Starbucks. I go to Starbucks a lot. I like to work at Starbucks. It gives me the opportunity to be around other people. You know, being alone in my office sometimes is just too quiet, so I go to Starbucks. But one of the things I love about going to Starbucks is when you go somewhere so many times with a great regularity, what happens? They start to know you, don't they? They know you. They know you by name. In fact, this one gal that's working at Starbucks, I walked in the other day, and we haven't talked much, and she said, "Hi, Cory." And I said, "Wow, you remembered my name. Like, that's amazing. Did you remember my name?" She goes, "Yeah." I'm like, "How did you remember my name? I mean, I came in once for a cup of coffee with her, and she remembered my name." Also last week when I went in and I grabbed a cup of coffee, before I could even place my order, another individual had already started, who works, had already started making my coffee. And then they turned around and said, "You do want the short coffee, right?" I'm like, "Yes, I do. Thank you very much." You see, it's like that because we want to be a part of somewhere where they know us, right? Where we really feel like we can belong. It's for this reason that when we lived in Utah for 18 years and planted a church there, that I found one barber, and I was there at that barber for 18 years, the same guy. And anytime I go back to Utah, that's where I go because the barber cleans up the mess that the people here make of my hair when I go, right? So I go back to them, and it's a place where when I walk in, they know me. Not only that barber after 18 years, of course, and all the conversations you've had, but also the other barbers, they know you as well. You see, we like that, don't we? We like that as people. We like to go places where people know us, places where we feel like we can belong. I don't know if you remember, well, some of you would remember this. A number of years ago, the massively popular TV show called Cheers. It aired from 1982. Man, that's a long time ago now, right? To 1993. And it was this massive success. It had won 6 Golden Globes. And if you remember that show, you'll remember the theme song if you were to hear it. The song was called "Where Everybody Knows Your Name." Do you remember that? I'm not going to sing it for you, but I'm going to give you the lyrics. Making your way in the world today takes everything you've got. Taking a break from all your worries sure would help a lot. Wouldn't you like to get away? All those nights when you've got no lights, the check is in the mail, and your little angel hung the cat up by its tail, and your third fiancé didn't show. Sometimes you want to go where everybody knows your name, and they're always glad you came. You want to be where you can see our troubles are all the same. You want to be where everybody knows your name. That song was a huge success. It was a hit, not only because it was catchy, but because the lyrics in the TV show really struck a chord in the human heart. Because all of us desire to belong. All of us desire to have a place where everybody knows our name, and they're always glad that we came. Don't we want that? Indeed, we do. But why do we desire this belonging in our lives? It's because God made us this way. God made every single one of us with this internal desire to belong, and He made us for connection with other human beings, for community, and not for isolation on an island. We've spent 3 years recently, haven't we, dealing with the lack of community and isolation because of COVID. And we've seen what that's done to people. Because God didn't make us for that kind of isolation. But the challenge that we face often today is that so many people seek belonging and community and connection in ways that ultimately just they will never actually satisfy them. Of this, a man named Bruce Larson commented on this. He said these words, "The neighborhood bar is possibly the best counterfeit there is to the fellowship that Christ wants to give his church. It's an imitation, dispensing liquor instead of grace, escape rather than reality, but it is a permissive, accepting, and inclusive fellowship. It is unshockable. It is democratic. You can tell people secrets, and they usually don't tell others or want to. The bar flourishes not because most people are alcoholics, but because God has put into the human heart the desire to know and be known, to love and to be loved, and so many seek a counterfeit at the price of a few beers, and largely because they don't know any other way. You see, God's plan for all of us is that we would find authentic community, authentic connection and belonging in two primary ways. First and foremost, we find true belonging when we accept the good news about Jesus Christ. The moment that we believe in Jesus Christ, that he came into this world, he died on the cross for our sins, he was buried, and he was raised to life. When we accept that message, we are what the Bible describes as born again. In that very moment, you enter into a spiritual family, a family that is found all across the world. But there's another way in which this connection happens in true belonging. You see, because once we've entered into that true spiritual family, he wants us to belong to a local family, a local church family, where other followers of Jesus Christ gather for the purpose of authentic community, connection, and what the Bible calls fellowship. And it was to this authentic community that the first Christians in the book of Acts, in the New Testament, were devoted. In Acts chapter 2, verse 42, it says this of those early Christians, that they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, the breaking of bread, and prayers. The first Christians devoted themselves to the fellowship. Now, what does that mean that they devoted themselves to the fellowship in this passage? Notice it's they devoted themselves to these things. The word fellowship in Greek is the word koinonia, which carries this basic meaning and idea of association or communion or fellowship, it can simply mean, or this closeness of relationship that exists. They were devoted to each other, in other words. They had a commitment towards primarily first the Lord, but secondly to one another. And though they were not all the same, they shared this life together because it was this one true message, the gospel about Jesus Christ, that brought them all together as family, as brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, being a part of a family is not easy, is it? I mean, think of your own biological family. Maybe you've got a fantastic family and you wouldn't think this, but I know a lot of people who are like, listen, I've got family members that, you know, yeah, we just won't go down that road. We know that being part of a family is not that easy. Though Scripture calls us to devote ourselves to fellowship and to authentic community, sometimes, if we're honest about this, we just don't want to be devoted to the family. We just don't want to be devoted to the church family in particular. And why is that? It's because people have a way of disappointing us, don't they? They really do. You know, we're a gathering of individuals here, and we are all, whether we acknowledge it or not, Scripture says that we're all sinful people. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. There's not a single person in here, myself included, not a single one of us, that doesn't sin and fall short of God's glory. We're imperfect, fallen, sinful people. And the moment you get a group of imperfect, sinful, fallen people together, there's going to be problems that exist among them. Because sinful people end up doing things to people that are sinful, that are hurtful. Sometimes connecting to a church is difficult because people have disappointed you. Leaders have caused you potentially to be disillusioned. For some, perhaps some of you here today, you've been hurt by a church, a person, an individual in the church, a group in the church, a leader in the church. You've had bad experiences with the family of God. You've been burned. And so because of being burned, you don't want to be burned again. And man, I get that. Boy, do I get that. Sometimes it's a lot easier to go into retreat mode and hide and go into isolation. Sometimes it takes a while to get back on your feet again when you've been so hurt and wounded. And oftentimes it certainly can take a long time for a person to find healing. And when we've been hurt, the normal human response, of course, is to recoil in pain, to isolate, and to live as if we are on an island somewhere. You know, to be like the person, and some of you will know this song, in Simon and Garfunkel's song, I Am a Rock. Remember that old song? A winter's day in a deep and dark December, I am alone, gazing from my window to the streets below on a freshly fallen silent shroud of snow. I am a rock. I'm an island. I've built walls, a fortress deep and mighty that none may penetrate. I have no need of friendship. Friendship causes pain. It's laughter and it's loving I disdain. I'm a rock, I'm an island. Don't talk of love. Well, I've heard the word before. It's sleeping in my memory. I won't disturb the slumber of feelings that have died. If I never loved, I never would have cried. I'm a rock, I'm an island. I have books and my poetry to protect me. I'm shielded in my armor, hiding in my room, safe within my womb. I touch no one and no one touches me. I'm a rock, I'm an island, and a rock feels no pain and an island never cries. All that song is a song filled with hurt. With somebody who's been so hurt in life, and as a result of that, they just want to isolate themselves and they claim they don't need anybody else, but of course they do. They just don't want to be hurt again. Friends, Harvest has been through a lot. And those of you who've been around know. And that's hard to get over sometimes. But the Lord isn't like that. People fail. The Lord never does. And so while isolation is a natural response, we cannot escape the reality that we were made for this human connection, and the Word of God calls us to be deeply rooted in community, not on the periphery, but rather at the center. And why is that? Why does the Lord want us to be deeply rooted in community, in authentic community? I want to give you four reasons this morning. Four reasons that we need to be deeply rooted in community. The first reason is this: being deeply rooted in community helps us to handle the harsh realities of life. Now, as much as I go, for example, to jiu-jitsu, and I enjoy the community that's in jiu-jitsu, the jiu-jitsu community that I enjoy there helps me at a certain level with things, okay? It helps me to develop, hopefully, Liam Neeson-like skills. But there's also another level to the community, but it's only going to take me so far. The community at Starbucks is very superficial still. It's good, but it's not going to take me and give me really what I need. The Chick-fil-A community is not going to give me what I need, although in the moment it sure does. You see, you need true community, authentic community, to help you with the harsh realities of life. Because life, as you know, if you've been around for any period of time, has a way of absolutely beating you up and tearing you down and leaving you on the ground and kicking you when you're down. And it's awfully hard to get back up again. You see, a genuine sense of belonging helps us to handle those harsh realities, because true community is found, for example, expressed in passages like Romans chapter 12, verse 15, where Paul said, rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Or in 1 Corinthians 12, 26, when he said to the Corinthians, if one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. To the churches of Galatia in Galatians chapter 6, verse 2, Paul said to the church, he said, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. You know, when we're on the periphery of church life, or when somebody periodically comes to church, it's out of love that we would say to them, please come more often. Because we know that the harsh realities of life will come if they're not there already. And it's awfully hard when you're on the periphery or when you're extremely irregular, if you're what we've often described as C&E Christians, that's Christmas and Easter Christians, and you come to church to know what's going on in your life and how we can love and care for you. You see, the call to community, the call to deeper community is born out of a love and a desire to be able to help people deal with the harsh realities of life when they come into our life, because it's not a question of if they come. It's when they come. We're all going to cross over into all kinds of challenges. As we heard last week in the message, the wilderness of the soul. Hard stuff happens. So when we weep, we need others to weep with us. When we mourn, we need others to mourn with us. When we suffer, we need others to suffer alongside of us. When we're burdened, we need others who will bear the burden for us or with us. One of my favorite scenes from The Lord of the Rings, The Return of the King. If you haven't seen it, well, I don't know why you haven't. It's a great movie. One of my favorite scenes, though, is when Frodo Baggins and Samwise are climbing up the mountain to get rid of the ring. But Frodo is so overcome with exhaustion from carrying the burden of this ring because of how evil it is that he absolutely cannot continue. And at this point, Samwise, if you remember the scene, he looks at his good friends, and these words are absolutely just beautiful. He says, "Come on, Mr. Frodo. I can't carry it for you, but I can carry you." And Samwise then picks up Frodo and carries him up the mountain, and in so doing, he helps bear his burden. Isn't that a terrific picture? There are literally times in our lives when you can't carry yourself up the mountain. Dark places that we get to. Discouragement, depression, anxiety, fear. The loss of a loved one, a horrible diagnosis in our lives or somebody else's lives, where all of a sudden everything is lost from us and we don't know what to do. Friends, it's that time we need community. God has designed it that way. We need Him and we need His community in our lives. And so if you're not deeply rooted in community, what will you do when those inevitable hardships and pains and struggles and heartaches of life come knocking at your door? Commit yourself to be deeply rooted in community. Secondly, being deeply rooted in community helps us to live graciously with others. Now, I remember when I first became a Christian, I was 17, and being 19 now. why is that so funny? I mean, when I became a Christian at 17, I remember, you know, it was me and the Lord and the Word of God. And life was so simple, so simple. Although back then it felt so complicated. But looking back, it was so simple. And I remember thinking to myself as I studied, like, okay, Christian character. Not that I ever thought I've got this mastered. I don't mean to communicate that. Because I felt a lot of sin in my life, too, that I struggled with. But there are often times I didn't think about certain things in my life as ever being problems in my life, like impatience. Or might be anger, or it could have been any kind of issue like that, any kind of sort of character deficiency and flaw. And you know, God has this great way in terms of what He's done and how He's created things, why He's created certain things for our benefit and for our good. So He created one of the very first things before there was ever government or everything. What did He do in the garden? He created Adam and Eve. He created marriage to exist, didn't He? You see, marriage is by God's design, so many things, but it's this too. It's by God's design, His sort of place where He uses marriage to grow us. I mean, think about it. When you're alone and you're by yourself, That's one thing. But now you enter into the most, or what's supposed to be the most intimate relationship you will ever have. And what happens? I can't believe that the toothpaste roll is not rolled up properly. And I can't believe the towels are laying around. I can't believe. And all kinds of things emerge, right? All these new sort of things pop up. And you see, what happens is in the closeness of the community, of a marriage, the real you starts coming out. The real me starts coming. Somebody says, well, that's not me. I don't know what's happened to me. No, friend, that is you. That is you. It just hadn't had an opportunity to sort of rear its ugly head, you see. You know, when you're by yourself, you're like, you know, I'm great. I can take. You know, but when you get in close community, boy, that stuff comes to the surface. It's stuff that was already there. It's rising up now within you. And then you think, okay, I got this now. And then for some reason, you decide to have children. And when you have children, what happens? Another layer of this. You know, you have one kid, and you're like, good Lord, what did we do? We love our kid, but why did you, super stubborn, strong-willed kid. And oh my, like, and now you're being stretched even more in terms of your capacity to be patient, for example. Or how do you deal with exhaustion? I mean, you know, if you're your parent, you've been there, you know that. You know what it's like to go through that. And then you had a second kid in there. And then you're like, okay, we've got two of us, that's two hands each. So let's add a third because we still have another hand. And then in our family, we added a fourth, so we had four kids. I remember after kid number one feeling, man, I am exhausted. I mean, I was up every night. No, I wasn't. You're like, don't you go there, Cory. The reality is with every kid, I felt like, man, a quarter of my energy was like sucked out of my body. By the time I had four, I was like, felt like I was like a walking like corpse. I just like going, man, I am so completely, well, all of that, what is it? Again, it's God's design, right? It's God's plan for the family, for the marriage. It's God's plan for with children. And sort of when you do have children, or if you do have children, then all of these things, what happen? They raise up, they bring up all of these things that are down there, the things that God is using as tools and instruments in your life and my life to actually grow us and mature us and help us to go deeper. And it's really important that we respond rightly to those things. And you know, the church is a community as well, right? So friends, when I say to you that being deeply rooted in community helps us to live graciously with others, this is God's plan for our lives. People, when they come into church and they say, well, I'm going to be part of the community and I like this church, you know, there's part of me that wants to say, that's great. Recognize ahead of time that you're a sinful person and everybody else in here is sinful as well. And there is going to be, at some point in your existence here, something that you don't like or don't feel or somebody that might not agree with or, you know, have the same opinion or view about a matter. But what do you do in community is what matters, right? Just like in marriage and just like with our parenting, God gives the church community as a way for actually helping us to really mature and grow and develop. You know, we grow so much because of our marriages. We grow so much because of our parenting. And we grow so much when we commit ourselves to authentic community through the thick and thin of church life. You and I have to learn how to be gracious with other people. You and I have to learn how to love one another. We have to learn how to bear other people's burdens. We have to learn how to agree with somebody or disagree with somebody in love and graciously. We have to learn all of these things and so many more. And what better place to learn them than in God's family as His divinely appointed community? I mean, just consider how diverse we are, right? Diversity creates an incredible amount of opportunity for conflict and problems in anywhere you go. In a sense, various countries. I know this room, that there's people here that are from different countries. Various ethnic, cultural, social backgrounds. We come various types of education. and educational levels, differing life experiences, religious backgrounds even for some people, where they've come out of, what they currently hold to and believe, different political views, differing skills, talents, temperaments. Added to this is a diversity of maybe denominational backgrounds and ways of looking at certain biblical and theological issues, which I won't dive into the whole long list of all of them, and why we don't always think about sort of non-essential issues the same way. We won't always agree over those. But is that not the beauty of the church? For in such rich diversity like that, we also have an opportunity to learn to be gracious with each other. Oh, sure, on those things that are absolute core and essential, like who God is and what salvation is, like there's what the Bible teaches, and that's crystal clear and that's done. But I'm talking about all the other stuff. You see, the Apostle Paul recognized this when he wrote Romans 14. I want to read this to you. In fact, this Wednesday's Bible study in the book of Romans, as we come to the end of that study in the next few weeks, we actually find this is the text that we're in for the study this week. In Romans 14, here's what Paul says. As for the one who is weak in faith, welcome him, but not to quarrel over opinions. One person believes he may eat anything, while the weak person eats only vegetables. Let not he or the one who eats despise the one who abstains, and let not the one who abstains pass judgment on the one who eats, for God has welcomed him. Who are you to pass judgment on the servant of another? It is before his own master that he stands or falls, and he will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One person esteems one day as better than another, while another esteems all days alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. The one who observes the day observes it in honor to the Lord. The one who eats, eats in honor of the Lord, since he gives thanks to God. While the one who abstains, abstains in honor of the Lord and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, every tongue shall confess to God. So then, let each of us give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let us not pass judgment on one another any longer, but rather decide never to put a stumbling block or hindrance in the way of a brother. I know and am persuaded in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in itself, but it is unclean for anyone who thinks it is unclean. For if your brother is grieved by what you eat, you are no longer walking in love. By what you eat, you destroy. Do not destroy your brother. Or do not destroy the one for whom Christ died. So do not let what you regard as good be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Whoever thus serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved by men. So then let us pursue what makes for peace and for mutual upbuilding. Do not for the sake of food destroy the work of God. Everything is indeed clean, but it is wrong for anyone to make another stumble by what he eats. It is good not to eat meat or drink wine or do anything that causes your brother to stumble. Now, what's happening in this passage? Paul here, as he writes to the church in Rome, is concerned over those in the family of God and how they were treating each other actually in the church. And two issues were being faced by the Christians in Rome, because the church consisted in this early day as those who were Jews and then the non-Jews, the Gentiles, and they had come together in the name of Jesus as followers of Jesus Christ in the church, and it wasn't the easiest mixture in the beginning. There were issues that were there. There were things that the Gentiles thought and the way they lived that were completely opposite to the way that the Jews thought about things. The Jews made much more at that time about food and certain food restrictions and certain days like the keeping of the Sabbath. Gentiles had no regard for absolutely any of that. What the Apostle Paul does is he cuts through all of that And his point is with both groups is that they need to learn to live graciously with each other. He did not want the believers in Rome to quarrel over opinions over these matters or despise each other or to pass judgment on one another. He wanted the believers to stop trying to control how others think and recognize that not everyone is going to think the same over those kind of issues. Instead, he encouraged them in verse 15, I want you to walk in love. And then in verse 19, to pursue what makes for peace and for mutual upbuilding. You see, true fellowship and authentic community challenges us in this, doesn't it? This is nothing new in the church like today. It's not just today. This goes all the way back to the first century. We see it in Romans 14. The church came together, diverse people who came together, and they had to work through how do we do this because we have this different ethnic and sort of religious backgrounds. The thing that's brought us together, though, is that we've all heard the message about Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins, was buried, and rose again, and we've accepted him as our Savior. But boy, we've got some differences about things. We have so many of these kind of things that happen in today. I mean, a lot of this stuff has changed over the years, but used to be a time period when there would be Christians who'd be like, are you kidding me? We don't go to movies. I mean, are you kidding me? We don't play with a deck of cards. The cards are evil. I mean, that's the slippery slope to sexual morality, right? That's kind of the stuff, right? I mean, there's a whole list of things. I mean, Christians dancing, are you kidding me? Christians do not dance. Now, some of us maybe look back and you remember that day in the Christian faith. If you're younger, you maybe aren't familiar with that even at all. You might go, well, that was a thing? Yeah, that and many other things were things, right? And there was sometimes a lot of judgment that came as a result of it. You went to see an R-rated movie? Are you kidding me? No R-rated movie is ever worth going to see, right? That kind of thing. You went to see a play, a performance? You didn't do that. Where did you go? You sat at a bar. Yeah, it was in Chili's, okay? But you still went to a bar. Right, like all of those things became massive issues in the Christian church. You got a tattoo. What? You're a guy and you got your ears pierced. What? You have long hair. Are you kidding me? Like it goes on and on and on. And all of those things, in many of them, when you look at them, what are they? They're nothing. They're nothing. Boy, we need to learn to live graciously. It's not to say that people don't cross a line into sin, right? Because we do. They're still right and they're still wrong. But boy, when we come together, for the Jews and the Gentiles in that day, it was about food. What food is permissible to eat? What is not permissible to eat? It was about days, feasts and festivals. And the Jews had to sort of in some ways let go of that because it didn't matter anymore. But the Gentiles didn't treat the Jews well and the Jews didn't treat the Gentiles well. Thirdly, being deeply rooted in community helps us to live out the one another commands of the Bible. The New Testament has over 50 one another commands that we are called to live out. 50 of them. Did you know that? So they're written not to those who are outside the church. They're commands that are written to us in the church. 50 commands that are called one another's. These are ways that we're to practically and in very tangible ways live in community with one another. It is virtually impossible to live out these commands just sort of out there. They're meant to be lived out in community. So when somebody says, you know, I believe in Jesus, but I don't go to church at all. I'm not saying that it's not possible for them to believe in Jesus and know him, but I would be saying to them this. You cannot live out what God has called you to live, how he's called you to live, as a person outside the church. I mean, I'm not talking outside of the building. I'm talking about outside of community. You cannot live the way God wants you to live because there's 50 plus commands, one another commands in Scripture, that you cannot live out because these are commands that you do to one another in the context of the community of God. That and a whole host of other things that you can't do if you're not part of church. that are commanded to do. Hearing of the word, the receiving of communion, right? Like it is a whole host of them. I think I've given you a sample of these 50 commands in your notes this morning. I mean, we're commanded to wash one another's feet, to love one another, be devoted to one another, honor one another, live in harmony with one another, stop passing judgment on one another, accept one another, instruct one another, greet one another with a holy kiss. Okay, maybe just greet one another. Agree with one another, serve one another, bear with one another, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgive one another, speak to one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, submit to one another, teach and admonish one another, encourage one another, spur one another on to love and good deeds, offer hospitality to one another, clothe yourself with humility toward one another, confess your sins to one another, pray for one another, do not slander one another, do not grumble against one another, do not lie to one another, be kind to one another, live in peace with one another, build up one another, carry one another's burdens, consider one another better than yourself. That is quite a list. I mean, sometimes I've reflected on these 50 and I thought, Lord, I could just take one of these things and just try to start working it in my life. I could be overwhelmed by the 50 plus, but if I'm really connected and committed to community, these 50 are going to matter to me, and they're going to matter to you. You know, when we gather on Sundays, we gather as the body of Christ, as his church, and we can be more than spectators, or we can be more than recipients of ministry, more than just receivers. We can be givers, and I don't mean in the financial sense. I mean givers in terms of the way we give to one another, the way we practice the one another's, the way we live out the one another's here in Scripture. You don't need a ministry title to do that. You don't need a ministry position to do that. You don't need a ministry role or responsibility to do that, because you and I, friends, we're called. If you're a follower of Jesus, we're called to live out the one another's. So it's a beautiful thing in the church when you see young families having children and the church rally around the family and bring food to the family. Like, that's just one easy expression of that, right? There's a multitude of them. You don't have to have it programmed and planned. You can initiate. You can lead. You can step forward. You can be in the lobby. You can be interacting. And you can think of these one another's and how you do this. When you come to church on a Sunday morning, coming and not simply saying, Lord, give me something today. Sure, say that and ask that. You should say, Lord, I want everything from you that you have for me this morning. But also come on a Sunday morning to say, Lord, use me this morning. Help me to live out the one another commands. Give me the opportunity to speak for you, to be a voice to somebody else, to be an encouragement to somebody else, to find out who's hurting and broken and who's struggling and whose burden I might be able to bear. That's the church in action. You know, as we move forward into the fall and we relaunch this campus, friends, this is going to be so critical for us as a church. Like this series about being deeply rooted, it rolls itself out because, Lord willing, as God brings more people here into our church, we're the ones who are going to make that happen in terms of our new folks that come, in terms of welcoming them, enfolding them. And our what we do on a Sunday morning is so important, but what we do has to go beyond a Sunday morning as well. Such a great impact happens when we can say to somebody, you know, we're going to go for lunch. I'd love to have you join us. Or next Sunday, would you like to come over for lunch? Or, you know, just inviting people into your community group, inviting people to take a step closer, to step in, to find those who are new and to say, listen, we're so glad that you're here. Like to just really be that kind of community is so critical for us as a church as we go forward. And then fourth, being deeply rooted in community helps us to stand strong spiritually. We get spiritual strength when we're together. And so to be strong spiritually, we need to gather regularly to hear the apostles' teaching and engage in fellowship, the breaking of bread and prayer. And if we're not gathering, we really are putting ourselves at spiritual risk because we're cutting ourselves off from the means of grace that God has ordained for us to stand strong. When we're encouraged to come to church, it's again out of love to say, we actually really need this. We really need this. We need to hear the word of God. And I trust this is true for you. There are Sunday mornings sometimes when I hear worship and the songs and the lyrics remind me and lift my spirit and encourage me. They help me to deal sometimes with anxious thoughts that I might have or dark clouds that sometimes might want to cloud in upon me. They remind me and they raise me up again. We need that, don't we? Consider, for example, what the author of Hebrews had to say in Hebrews chapter 10. He said, "Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near." The gathering together, and the not neglecting of that, and the need for encouragement. True community really does help us to stand strong. To stand strong, in fact, like those great sequoia redwood trees. You ever seen those? I've seen them in person. I've met the General Sherman, the big redwood. The sequoia redwood trees are in California. They're some of the biggest trees in the world. And the General Sherman is noted as the largest known living single stem tree on earth. Incredible. It's 275 feet tall, 25 feet in diameter, approximately 2,500 years old. And something that huge, you would think, would have this incredible root system that goes way down deep in order for that thing that's 275 feet tall to be able to not fall over. But the oddity of this is that's not the case at all. It's a completely different root system. Some trees have what's called a taproot system, where the root goes, there's a taproot that goes way down deep, and then roots break off and branch off from that to give it stability so that what's above the ground is matched in some respects by what's under the ground, massive root systems. The sequoias have massive root systems too, but they're not deep. Their roots are relatively shallow. There's no taproot to anchor them deep. The roots actually only go down, in contrast to 275 feet up, they only go down 6 to 12 feet. And yet these trees rarely ever fall over. They withstand strong winds, earthquakes, fires, storms, flooding. But how can something that's 500 tons, reaching over 300 feet in height, live for many centuries, remain standing with roots going only down about 10 feet? How does that happen? Well, the interesting thing about this, the redwood trees, is that the root system is intertwined with the other redwood trees. That's how. They literally are holding each other up. The trees grow very close together. They're dependent on each other for nutrients as well. Only the redwoods have the strength and ability to support the other redwoods. Other trees don't. So beneath the surface of these massive, tall trees are roots, like an army of men that have their arms all interlocked, standing and supporting each other, and they're preventing the adversaries of life from knocking them down. And they're making sure there's plenty of nutrients for growth to continue. Boy, is that not a picture of the church? Is that not a picture of authentic community? Friends, you and I can stand strong spiritually and grow deeply, be so deeply rooted when we really interconnect with each other as the body of Christ. There's going to come a time as your pastor that I'm going to need you. And there's going to come a time that you're going to need me and you're going to need each other. We're going to have this in our lives. So friends, let's be deeply rooted to community. Deeply rooted. A healthy church is a place where the people of God desire God and they desire to be deeply rooted to his people, and they encourage and also invite others to believe in Jesus Christ and enter into that community. So I want to urge you in conclusion to lean into community, to be friendly towards those who are new, a friendliness that goes beyond Sunday morning, a friendliness that welcomes those who are new into the life of the church to experience the joys of belonging to a family, to live in community in such a way that you greet one another, you serve one another, you love one another, you speak to one another, you encourage one another, you hang around after Sunday service if you can and you talk to one another, you introduce yourself to somebody that you don't know, you have people in your home, you grab coffee with somebody, you join a community group, you go on a walk, you attend special events that happen at the church where you can connect with others, you're consistent in coming to church, and you're just a difference maker here. You're a difference maker at Harvest Bible Chapel North Shore. And you're a difference maker because you're deeply rooted in so many areas of your life as we've gone through in this series, and you're deeply rooted in community. May God help us as we go forward as a church, as we continue to revitalize and rebuild and with the goal of relaunching in the fall. May God help us to be that kind of deeply rooted people. For his glory, in Jesus' name, right? Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you, Lord, that we have the privilege of knowing you and loving you. And Lord, we ask that as we go forward today, that you would help us to have a strong desire, Lord, brought by your Holy Spirit, into our lives to be deeply rooted, to know you more deeply, to love you, Lord, passionately. Lord, to long for you and for your word and for time with you in prayer. And Lord, for your presence in the midst of those hard times of the soul where we're in the wilderness. And Lord, when we're in community, help us not only to receive what we need from others, but Lord, to be part of that root system that wraps our arms around each other in whatever season of life our brothers and sisters are in, that we can be deeply rooted. And we pray for your work in our church to build us, to grow us, for the glory of God, for the praise of Jesus, so that we can go forward as a church and reach other people with the gospel of Jesus Christ, that they might enter into community and find authentic community, true belonging in a relationship with you and with your church. We pray this in Jesus' name.